And now I'm truly honored to introduce our 2014 commencement speaker, Kent Hance, Chancellor of the Texas Tech University System. He's a Red Raider, a 1965 graduate of Texas Tech University with a Bachelor of Business Administration in Finance. He's a former Texas State Senator, Texas Railroad Commission Chairman, and U.S. Congressman. In 1981, then Congressman Hance authored President Reagan's tax bill, which remains the largest tax cut in American history. He's an attorney who founded a successful law firm in Austin. He's a true champion for this university, higher education, and the great state of Texas. Since becoming chancellor in December of 2006, system enrollment has increased 45%. System research expenditures have nearly tripled since 2006 and now average about $200 million per year. The number of degrees awarded in the system is up 46%. Under the chancellor's leadership, more than $1.2 billion has been raised for the Texas Tech system. As a result of this achievement, the Texas Tech System endowment is now over $1 billion. Chancellor Hance is not just a fundraiser. When out there raising funds, he follows his own advice and puts his money where his mouth is. Personally, he's giving back more to Texas Tech than he's made in his salary as chancellor. He will become chancellor emeritus very soon, but yet he'll still teach a class on our campus and help in various other ways. Chancellor Hance is many things, but most importantly, he's a true supporter of Texas Tech University. Kent Hance loves this university. And at this time, please help me welcome Chancellor Kent Hance.
I love Texas Tech. I loved every minute of it. My parents brought me here in 1961 and let me out, and I've loved everything about it. I graduated in 4 years, and if I had it do over, I'd do it 14 or 15 probably. Now that's a joke. That's a figure of speech. Don't be going telling people, it's okay if you take 14. We're glad that you did it in four or five or six or, you know. We're glad you're here. This is a fun day. I want to make, before I start my speech, I want to make one announcement that I think is very important. You will see some of the men and women in this graduating class that will have a camouflage stole. And would those in the graduating class, if you have that, would you stand up? They have served their country and they came back to school here. Texas Tech is one of the most military-friendly universities in the nation. And I think that's something. One other thing I want to do, I would like for everyone in the audience that has served in the military to please stand. We thank you. We're proud of you. You got a degree from the best university in the world. I'll give you a few facts. Remember, I talked to you at orientation. I mean, it's been a short time ago. Time flies when you're having fun. Wall Street Journal did an article, and they interviewed 459 college recruiters, and they said, where do you get the best students? We were number one in the Big 12. We were number 18. Nationwide, out of 4,000 schools. Number 18, we were ahead of the University of Virginia. We were ahead of University of Virginia, University of Illinois, Notre Dame, MIT, some great schools. But I think one of the reasons we get good material, you came from homes, if you've got a job from 9 to 5, you get there before 9. And you show up and you do your work. And at 5 o'clock, if you don't have everything done and done properly, you stay till it's done. You outwork the opposition. That's one of the things that makes our alums so proud that everyone loves to see them. Now, there was a survey came out 3 weeks ago yesterday and said, what's your dream school? They interviewed 10,000 high school students spread throughout the nation. Said, what is your favorite university? What's your dream school? And they listed, and they listed the top 100. And Harvard was number one, then Yale, then Stanford, then Michigan, then Princeton. We were the top one in the state of Texas. We were listed number 23 in the nation. University of Texas, Austin, they did pretty good. They were 42. And we were proud for Baylor. They were 71, and Rice was 88. That's all that were in the top 100. Somebody's missing. But I also want to talk to you. Our alums, when General Motors went broke, Congress and the White House didn't call on someone from Harvard, Yale, or Stanford. They got a Texas Tech person to turn it around, Ed Whitaker. The only person in the history of the world that has had, that's been CEO and chairman of the board of two of the 10 largest companies in the world, AT&T and General Motors. And he's on the board at Exxon. He came to Texas Tech. No one in his family had ever been to college before. And we didn't tell him, you can't do that. You can do that. Angela Brawley, Forbes magazine lists the 100 most powerful women in the world every year. And she's been on that list 6 out of 7 years. 1 year she was listed number 4. And I called her and I said, I am so impressed, Angela. You're ahead of Hillary Clinton and Oprah Winfrey both. And she said, hey, my little sister's impressed. I'm ahead of Queen Elizabeth. I like that. Susan Graham has 2 music degrees from Texas Tech. If you go to the New York Metropolitan Opera, she's the lead soprano, one of the top rated mezzo-sopranos in the world. If you watch the 5:30 news on CBS, the anchor is Scott Pelley, another Texas Tech person. If you watch Fox News, Jim Engel, their White House correspondent, another Texas Tech person. John Alexander is the captain of the USS Abraham Lincoln, largest aircraft carrier in the world. He's from Port Neches Groves and has his degree from Texas Tech. The president of the Iraqi Trade Bank, Hussein al-Yuziri, 1985 graduate of Texas Tech. And in sports, just briefly, Dallas Lee Braden is the 18th person to ever throw a perfect game since 1880, and he's a Texas Tech person. And the leading receiver several years out of the last 7 years is Wes Welker, another Texas Tech person. Our people excel. They dream no little dreams. If you're going to dream little dreams, what I tell you when you're freshman, if you're going to dream little dreams, you got to go some other place, to the southeast. I'm not naming names. I've worked on that. One time I did that, and I got a nasty letter. It was kind of funny. Dream no little dreams, but execute on those dreams. Follow through. President McKinley in 1898 needed to get a message to General Garcia, who was head of the insurgents in Cuba fighting the Spaniards. And someone told him, there's a Colonel Rowan. He can get the message to if anyone can. They called him over. They gave him a leather pouch with a letter in it. They said, we're going to have a boat let you out on the south side of Cuba, and it'll pick you up 3 weeks later on the north side, and you need to find the general, give him the letter, and get an answer. And he said, where is the general? They said, he's somewhere in Cuba. Cuba doesn't look that big on a map, but it's big. And they said, he's in the jungle. Colonel Rowan did not ask for a consultant. He did not ask for a committee. He did his job. He delivered the letter, and he came out. Execution is the rarest talent that there is. A lot of people can be educated, but if they don't execute on the game plan, it's just not going to work. One of the turning points in Ed Whitaker's career was that when he was 31 years of age, he was working for AT&T in New York City. And he came in on a Monday morning, and he had a note. The CEO wanted to see him. He had never been called to the CEO's office. He asked his boss, "Are they going to fire me?" And his boss said something I liked. Said, "No, CEOs don't fire you. They hire people to fire you. So you're okay." He goes down, and he has the meeting, and they tell him, "Ed, do you know so-and-so?" And he said, "Yes, he's going to be the new in charge, president of Bell, Arkansas." They said, "Well, that was Friday, but his wife won't move to Arkansas, so it's out, and we've already called a press conference, and the press conference at 4 o'clock on Wednesday in Little Rock. Can you be there?" And he said, "Yes, I'll be there." He went back to his office, called his wife, Linda, and they'd made a decision early in their marriage. She's also a Texas Tech graduate. And they'd made a decision every time he got a chance to get a promotion, they were going to take it. So they didn't have to debate whether we leave or go or whatever. And he was there. Later, when he got to be CEO and chairman of the board of AT&T, one day he got to thinking he'd like to see his HR file. Remember, if you get to be CEO, you can get your HR file, and if someone wrote something nasty about you, you can fire them, you know. He got his file, and he was going through it, and there was a half-page memo typed about his move to Arkansas. But the CEO had written in longhand with a pen, "Ed Whitaker, when his number was called, he was ready. Be prepared. When your number's called, be ready." John Wooden, one of the greatest basketball coaches of all time, said, "If you wait to prepare when opportunity comes by, it's too late. You've missed it. So be prepared. You're going to have some goals. You're going to have some failures. You're going to have some successes. You got to have some failures." Thomas Edison, a reporter one time, told him, he said, "You've had hundreds of failures." He said, "No, I've had hundreds of ways that it doesn't work." He took a positive approach. You have to have some failures to be successful, because you got to be out there trying. One of my fraternity brothers at Texas Tech was a guy named John Duchendorf. He was leaving school before he graduated to go sing at Knott's Berry Farm in California. And so I went down and tried to talk him out of it. And I said, "You know, finish your degree in architecture." He went on, and later he changed his name from John Duchendorf to John Denver. And had he listened to me, he'd be making money as an architect in Houston or Dallas. But he was turned down in Hollywood and Nashville time after time, but he didn't give up. One other example, Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln lost 7 elections in a row before he won the presidency. One of the greatest presidents we ever had. Lost 7 in a row. I would have caught on after about number 3 or 4, you know. But he didn't, thank goodness. Communication. Dr. Kenneth Davis, one of my favorite professors, taught English at Texas Tech, and he always said this, and remember this, this is important. In communication, oral or written, it's not important that people understand you. It's got to be so concise they cannot misunderstand you. When you're giving instructions to an employee, make sure they're watching. Watch their body language. Body language is important. If you're a young man and you ask a young girl to go to dinner and she says, "Maybe, maybe," that's not a good sign. Ann Landers one time said, "Maybe from a woman means no." I think she was right on target. But watch their body language. Misinformation has caused wars to break out. One other thing, goals. Have those goals. Think about those goals. It's been said that each day should be filled with 8 hours of work, 8 hours of leisure and play, and 8 hours of sleep. Don't do that. Don't do that. Don't go for that 8, 8, and 8. You will not get to the top. 7 hours of sleep. I do about 5.5 or 6, but 7. And 7 hours of pleasure and 10 hours of work. Now, if you don't like a job you've got that's 8 hours, you're sure not going to like it if it's 10. Get something that you want to do that you enjoy doing. Outwork the opposition. Outsmart them. Be prepared. That's so important. also spend 5 minutes a day in meditation, prayer, whatever you want to call it. Where are you going? You get in touch with information from iPads, from everything you can imagine. There's so much going on. So try to make sure you've got 5 minutes a day that you sit in a chair and think about what you're going to be doing. Now, styles and fashions change. I realize that. I had a student a few weeks ago. He asked me, he said, Chancellor, do you have any twos? And I said, pardon? He said, do you have any twos? I said, well, I got two hands, two legs, two arms, two eyes. No, tattoos. And I said, no, I don't. He said, why not? And I don't know why, but he came into my, I said, have you ever seen a bumper sticker on a Bentley? And look, he looked at me when I said that, and I know in his mind he was saying, that's no Bentley. But it's my Bentley. Take care of yourself. Take care of your body. It's the only one you got. It's your Bentley. Take good care of it. Now, on tattoos, I don't care. I'm a big person on liberty. That's what this country was established on, liberty. That's your position. And if you have some, don't show them when you go interview for a big job. Unless there's exceptions to every rule. Unless you're trying to get a job in a tattoo parlor, then show them. You know, it's okay then. The information that you get, that I talked about, there's so much information. I did this yesterday. I'm going to do it again today. I got a Twitter account. You know, I saw that President Obama did a selfie and he had a Twitter account. I said, oh, he can do it. I know I can do it. I know I can do it. And so I want to get a picture with y'all. Hold on just a second. I'm not, my grandson and granddaughter, they're a lot better than this. Here we go. Y'all smile because it, and don't anybody have your eyes closed. Oh, you had your, put your guns up. Let's do one, get your guns up over here. We'll get to y'all in a minute. That's good. Okay, guns up over here. Okay, when you leave today, I've got you a poem, If, by Kipling. Read that at least once a week, the rest of your life. And the other thing, I bought all of you a t-shirt, and I want you to wear it with pride. In the back of it says, dream, no little dreams. You can do well. You're champions. You went to Texas Tech. You've got a great advantage. Take advantage. In this crowd, there are CEOs. There's best teachers, best social workers. There's people that can be members of Congress. I have the utmost confidence in this group. I love Texas Tech. I love y'all, and I'm proud of Texas Tech. God bless the Red Raiders.